I would like to welcome first for the third session of ICMIS 21 and introduce Dr. A.K. Singh Suryavanshi. He is a Vice Chancellor at Karnavati University as well as like a lot of other faculty got it. Very, very talented and got experience in the field of management and education. I would like to welcome you, sir, and hand over to you for to chair this session, sir.
Thank you so much, Dr. Shiv Agarwal ji, and also good morning to all colleagues here who have connected right now. Happy morning, and good to see everyone there on time, so that we are able to do justification with the time schedule. As you know that keeping the framework of ICMIS conference, we have got 20 minutes time for each paper. So I request that, kindly adhere your presentations and sharing to let's say 15 to 16 minutes, which I'll be giving a soft reminder of 15 minutes. And then so that we can have some time for Q&A, the scholars can ask. So I think first paper is paper code 2161. And this is about predicting online purchase intentions in cause-related marketing, investigating the role of CSR, cause involvement, and perceived value. So may I request Professor Suraj Manoj Kumar, and I think co-author is Professor Vasavada and Mr. Mahendran. So over to you. I guess this is interesting paper. It talks so about much, intersection.
Yeah, thank you so much, sir. Very good morning, sir, and very good morning to all the dignitaries connected over this platform. So let me share this slide. Yeah, I hope the slide is visible. Thank you. So the topic for today's presentation is predicting online purchase intention is cause-related marketing. It is investigating the role of CSR, corporate social responsibility, cause involvement, and perceived value. So paper is authored by myself, Dr. Maurabi Vasavada, and Dr. Mahendra Sharma. So let me start with the concept of cause-related marketing that typically talks about the process of formulating and implementing marketing activities. And that are viewed by an offer from the firm that generally talks about to contribute a specified amount to a designated cause. Say, for example, if we are aware with some of the campaigns, for example, Shanti Amla is donating 5% amount of that particular sale of the hair oil bottle, right? So they are contributing that 5% amount to the particular cause, and that can be defined as cause-related marketing. Right. In last 10 years, we observed that many online retailers have arisen in the Indian industry during the last decade, including Flipkart, BigBasket, Amazon, Grofers, Snapdeal, JioMart, TataClick, even StarQuick, etc. So actually, this concept of cause-related marketing began with the Kotler and Lewis article in the 1969. So the article was broadening the concept of marketing. So it was published in the year 1969. Later on, American Express promised to contribute 1% for every card transaction with reference to $1 for every new card issued during the last quarter of 1983. And through the restoration of the Statue of Liberty campaign, this particular campaign was concept was boosted. Right. By using cause marketing, American Express has contributed $1.7 million to the Statue of Liberty. In addition to that, American cardholders were increased by 45%. So when I talk about cause-related marketing, it is part and parcel of corporate social responsibility. So as I mentioned in this Venn diagram form, where corporate social responsibility consists of the cause-related marketing. So it becomes very crucial to understand for marketers and retailers how consumers will respond to cause marketing in the online environment, right? The previous studies from Indian perspective have found that cause marketing is utilized especially by three sectors on priority, FMCG, banking, and pharmaceutical, right? Where Qureshi and Thomas typically talked about the FMCG and they shared that it is highly used in the sector of FMCG. So our study has also examined the cause-related marketing consumer responses in the online environment, specifically with reference to the FMCG sector. So based on the in-depth literature review, we have reviewed almost more than 95 research papers for this research paper. And based on that, we found the five major variables. Considering time constraint, I'm not going in depth. So it is corporate social responsibility, cause involvement, perceived value, online purchase intention, and cause-related marketing. So why this study was required? That is concept of need for study, right? So due to usefulness to various stakeholders such as corporations, corporates, consumers, non-profit organizations, society, cause marketing has become the widely used marketing approach. And slowly and gradually, it has emerged a lot in last few years. Second, experimentation was heavily used in this process. Consequently, this research conducted a systematic assessment of CRM literature as well. Our research demonstrated that the customers see online retailers with cause marketing strategies more favorably in terms of trust and perceived value of shopping there. Right, the scope of the study is restricted to Ahmedabad, Baroda, Surat, Rajkot, based on the most populated cities of Gujarat. In addition to that, research is limited to personal care products of FMCG industry. So we have taken, we have considered oral care, hair care, skin care, cosmetics, deodorants, especially that segment of this FMCG industry. Further, the conceptual scope is limited to CSR, cause involvement, cause marketing, perceived value, and online purchase intention. Different demographic factors have also been taken into consideration, such as age, gender, marital status, education qualification, occupation, income, etc. Research gap, no studies have been conducted in India with reference to similar goals in CRM and online purchase intention. So we found this research gap, and that was a source of motivation to go for this study. Cause of the market in India hasn't looked at CSR as a factor in online trust. The link between cause engagement and purchase intention from CRM perspective has been studied in several research studies, right? But with specifically with reference to Gujarat, this particular study was missing. So we have tried to add value to the academia, fraternity, and even corporates. So we have framed major four hypotheses. So hypothesis one, that was talking about higher inferences about the CSR lead to higher online trust towards the website. Second, higher cause involvement leads to higher online trust. Third, higher perceived value leads to higher online trust towards website. And fourth, higher online trust towards the website leads to greater online purchase intention. So these are some demographic profiles. So out of 627 responses collected in Gujarat, we found a total 542 responses proper. So we have taken sample size of 542 rather than taking all the samples collected. So incomplete questionnaires were removed, improper responses were removed. So this is our demographic profile. Second, have applied MOS. So when I talk about the AVE value, so that is above 0.6 with reference to CSR, it is 0.749. With reference to cause involvement, it is 0.833. With reference to perceived value, it is 0.754. With reference to online trust, it is 0.626. So found that AVE value was comparatively very much higher. Composite reliability, it is above 0.8. It should be above 0.7, but it is above 0.8. And majority of the cases, it is 0.9. So in CSR, 0.937, cause involvement 0.952, perceived value 0.924, and online trust 0.869. So we found composite reliability also suitable for the paper. Next concept that talks about the standard factor loadings. So factor loading should be above 6.6, but here it is above 0.8. 0.7 is the lowest value, 0.723, which refers to online trust is the lowest value. So as factor loading is above 0.7, so standard factor loadings also suits to the study. Moving ahead, discriminant validity, we found 0.865 for CSR, cause involvement 0.913, perceived value 0.868, online trust 0.791, and online purchase intention 0.720, that is 0.72. So again, it is above 0.7, so discriminant validity was also found for the variables. When we talk about the results and discussion, as we have, as I have conveyed, 542 sample size was considered. 57% of the respondents were male, 43% were female. Demographics I have already shared. Moving ahead, important portion of the measurement model results that typically talks about due to factor loadings over 0.7 and highly significant validity was demonstrated. AVE was significantly over the threshold level, as we have discussed. Internal consistency of present model was found adequate, that is composite reliability was above 0.7. Proposed model has CFA achieving acceptable fit, so chi-square, that is 3.237. Requested value is less than 5, so it is also found suitable. CFI 0.960, TLI 0.952, were greater than 0.95, and RMSEA 0.064 was lesser than 0.8. So measurement results were also adequate. Structural equation model results, according to the results, all the model coefficients had the anticipated indications, and they were extremely significant. So when I talk up from the basis of hypothesis, right? So the result demonstrated that CSR has a favorable impact on consumers' online confidence. In the website as a result of this providing support the hypothesis one. Hypothesis two, that consumers' cause involvement is positively related to the online trust to the website. It is also confirmed. Since the result of this study, H3 is supported as consumers' perceived value is positively correlated with the online confidence. And fourth, the customers' online trust is favorably correlated with the desire to buy is also verified by the result. So this is a structured equation model, CSR, cause involvement, perceived value that leads to online trust. And online trust leads to the online purchase intention. So when we talk about the implications of the study, FMCG managers may use this model provided in this study to better understand the process of online test for a certain product categories. Additionally, they may utilize post marketing in the online marketplace to favorably affect the FMCG product sales. However, FMCG category could benefit from the use of managerial CRM promotional methods. Additionally, our research delivers key post marketing insights in an emerging market setting, and it may be expanded to a global scale to create the efficient online positive marketing campaign. So it can be even utilized from the online post marketing campaigns perspective. As a result, this research may be used to develop post marketing promotional marketing tactics in the online environment, so that this model will add value to overall fraternity in terms of the academia, in terms of the marketing, in terms of the society. So when we conclude, according to the conclusions of the study, CSR post participation perceived value have the favorable impact on the online trust. CSR activities appear to have positive effect on the internet trust, and perceived value was discovered to have a substantial influence on online trust, which is important information for the FMCG executive, since in this situation perceived advantages must outweigh perceived cost. And when we talk about the new normal scenario, so this study from the new normal scenario perspective after COVID situation, this new normal will in new normal demands some sort of this study which talks about the online purchase intention. So this study will well add value to the new normal perspective as well. So limitations and future scope. So further study can be expanded to, say, for example, pharmaceutical sectors, insurance sectors, even online ticket segment, even Ayurvedic FMCG market is developing day by day, right? Additionally, online trust will measure using three variables. Additional further variables can be taken into consideration, such as we can take product abuse, we can take product participation, we can take product type, previous donation, donation size, website interface, that can also be considered. The campaign's purpose was the environment, but it may be easily expanded to the other specialized causes such as education, health, or assisting physically challenged people, all of which could yield the distinct outcomes. So here I conclude my study. Thank you so much for the listening.
Okay, Dr. Shah, thank you so much for trying to complete well within time. So I think, you know, I request all the participants and friends in this conference, if you have few questions, you may please shoot to Dr. Shah. You can unmute and then speak. Interesting work. And but I think, you know, I request anyone, any interface, if you have.
I think, Dr. Shah, you have an excellent presentation here. Your statistics are very, very strongly supportive of your hypotheses. On my part, I would just want to make one comment, if I may.
Yes, yes,
and,
please.
One suggestion.
Yes, please.
And the comment is just basically, please take this in a little, you know, not too harsh or anything. But, you know, there is also in marketing, we have a term CRM, which is used for customer relationship management.
Yes.
So, you know, when you're using the acronym, just check what is the tradition in your you know, in your stream of research and how the expression CRM is used. If you don't mind, and just take a look at this, if you will, I'm going to put this on chat. I have a citation for the use of the acronym CRM. Of course, you'll find this in the literature. And there's a literature review by Nastaran and Zachariah.
Yes.
And you know, you might just find it interesting just to make the distinction that a reader of your article should be very clear which is the CRM that you are referring to.
Yes, ma'am. So in our paper, we have mentioned this as well, that in causalative marketing, they write CRM like this, so that it will not have any clash with the customer relationship management. So we have taken care in the research paper. We have mentioned it in the paper itself.
Right. I think that's a good way to handle it. And I would also venture to make one suggestion.
Yes, please.
That there is an upcoming author who's already been published, and basically he's from UT Dallas, and I'm going to just put his reference also. I have not seen your references list, Dr. Shah.
Yes.
But I would just recommend that you take a look at the writings of Dr. Kathuria.
Yes.
And his co-authors. And actually, I know Dr. Kathuria, he's got several articles in good journals which are
True.
Already under review and in the process of publication.
True.
So I think it would add value to your research if you include maybe one or two sites.
Sure. And even ma'am, our further next study that we are focusing upon, that is planning, that is that will cover Western India. So definitely I will take this reference into consideration. Thank you so much for this.
You're most welcome. And Stacey, you might find it useful, you might not, but you know, you'll be the
best. Definitely. And even ma'am, all the like whatever we are getting, that is always useful in our academia. So definitely it will be useful. Thank you so much.
All the best with your publication. Yeah.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Okay, Dr. Shah, so I think that's our thesis, but I think, you know, this paper is good. You know, as far as the cause related, you know, effects are concerned for the CSR and also trying to gauge the marketing purchasing intention. In that case, you know, CSR, have you tried to link it maybe in the next part about their revenue? You know, how much is the percentage of CSR they have spent? Actually, what is authorized? Up to 3% they should do as per the corporate laws of India.
Yeah.
But actually how much they did in that fiscal, you know, that will be interesting to see. And also second part is that, have they done the expenditure on CSR trying to see only around their products, or also they are open to the category as a whole? You know, because if I'm producing honey, it's not fair that I do my CSR expenditure around honey business itself.
True.
That's like back funnel, you know, doing. So maybe you can look at it, but thank you so much.
Thank you
for joining us. You can stop sharing the screen. And
okay. Thank you so much. Thank you.
So that was a lovely, you know, presentation by Dr. Suresh Shah and his team. So I invite now, you know, paper code 2164 by Gurpreet Kaur. This is about panel data estimation of liquidity risk drivers. So Gurpreet and her co-authors. Is she there or?
I don't see her online.
She has not joined. Okay, no problem. So I think then we'll go to the next author. I think I request, you know, paper code 2167, which is impact of critical factors of e-learning on e-learning outcome, sorry, on the learning outcome and a student's satisfaction during the test by Dr. Renuka and her co-authors.
Good morning, sir. This is Kiran Mehta. I'm one of the co-authors of the papers. So I'll be presenting this paper, right, sir?
Please.
Just give me a moment. I'll share my screen. I hope it is visible. Yes, sir. Is the slide visible to everybody? Just for the confirmation. Okay. Thank you so much, sir. Sir, to begin with, so as mentioned, the title of the paper is Impact of Critical Success Factors on E-Learning, on Learning Outcome and Student Satisfaction in Graduate Aptitude Test using D-Metal. So the authors are Renuka Sharma, Kiran Mehta, and Vanda Marza. So coming to a little background of the paper, what motivated this study and how it originated. So Vanda Marza, she's an industry person and she's working with Adology.com. She's a product marketing strategist there. So she's actually into the, you know, offering online products, and she's giving solution to the students who are preparing for graduate aptitude test using online portal, right? So the purpose of collaboration was to find out something which is useful for industry, where industry can help us to reach to the most authentic data, as the study is based upon experts. So Renuka Sharma and me, we are the academicians. So we have tried to bring something which is of, you know, useful for both academia, industry, both. So that was the motivation to see how it is emerging. So during these days, so we know that the role of online platform is increasing tremendously, and eventually due to pandemic's outbreak, we all have become used to of and have adapted to the, you know, using online platform for learning purpose also. Although this idea started even before that. So even before that, we were talking about conducting this study. So giving a little background of the study, as the title mentions that we are focusing on the e-learning platform. So a little bit introduction about that, what are the different, you know, options available for us? So what are the jargons prevailing these days? So we all are aware about that these days we are talking about MOOCs, massive open online courses, wherein the participants can have access to online resources. They can interact with world-class faculty. Both free and, you know, paid courses are available. Similarly, corporates have also started adopting this type of, you know, platform to upskill their employees. Infosys and TCS are the very good examples where they are providing employees their the chance through various online portals through which they can upskill themselves. So now the question is, these different types of online platforms when available with us. So when we try to match all these platforms with the, you know, e-learning stuff, usually e-learning is, so I'll not go in line by line. So I just want to make it more interactive and considering the time constraint also. So when we talk about the e-learning part, so usually in case of e-learning, see, I want to talk about these three forms. One is called self-paced, other is called, you know, blended. Self-paced, blended is something where you can use both the things. There can be recorded lectures also. So sometimes instructor is also providing you some sessions where you can have some doubt clearing session. So on the e-learning platform, there are absolutely, you know, recorded video-based lectures available to you. So all these types of platforms have different impact on the learning outcome and student satisfaction. So considering this part, that when a student is opting for e-learning education, so what exactly is affecting the student satisfaction and learning outcome? So the purpose of this study is to find out a causal relationship between these two, the where students' learning outcome and student satisfaction are the dependent variables, and we want to see what are the factors which are affecting their satisfaction and learning outcome. So which are usually referred to as critical success factors if we consider the literature in the context. Second, all this research is in the context of students who are preparing graduate aptitude tests to qualify for this some engineering programs across India. Okay, so moving further, so various theories are you know underlying this. Most commonly discussed is the constructivist theory, which is more about that whether there occurs creation of knowledge or not. Second, media richness theory is because everything is happening online. So if we talk about how the role of social media has, you know, increased during all this setup. So the most common names in case of e-learning players, if you talk about, these are the Coursera, Udacity, Simply Learn, edX, and Skillshare, and many more also. And if we talk about some statistics, so one of the report by, you know, KPMG, so they say 46% of India's population being under the age of 25. So acceptance of online channels increases as a result of many government programs aimed at increasing online education use. So the statistics, the facts available, and the platforms available for e-learning, they all are indicating, yes, there is a role of or e-learning can contribute a lot in the, you know, students' learning enhancement and satisfaction level. So what factors one needs to see while making such type of products. So moving further, so we try to extract some more information from the existing literature. So because as we said that we want to know which are the factors which affecting the learning outcome and student satisfaction from e-learning. So the broadly the literature, existing literature has identified good number of literature does exist, which talk about what are the critical success factors. And yes, we can categorize into different themes also. So the literature we studied, we could see that the critical success factors, these can be categorized into different sub-themes. So one is known as discourse, or sometimes it is also called as dialogue also. So it, this is how we have examined. So in-text citation speaks about that, yes, these are the authors which have indicated the importance of dialogues. Dialogue means a dialogue between student and dialogue between instructor and student in an online setting. So how does it contribute? Yes, there are evidences which are indicating that, yes, dialogue has an impact on the performance of the students. But yes, there are studies which says course grades may not directly affected by the, you know, dialogues between students and between student and instructor. In continuation with this, there are study, there's Arbog et al. 2007, they found that dialogues do have a significant effect on the student learning outcome. So many evidences are there which are indicating, yes, discourse or dialogue between student and faculty have a significant impact on the student satisfaction as well as on the learning outcome. So moving forward, so from the in-text citation, we could find many authors supporting this as a dialogue or discourse or discussion, which is used interchangeably, has a significant impact on the student satisfaction and learning outcome. Second important critical factor identified was the course design or the structure. So course design is one of the instructor's responsibility. So Moore has defined it, the course structure articulates the degree to which the objective teaching approaches and assessment procedures are rigid or flexible, and describe the amount to which an educational program can adapt or respond to each learner's particular needs. So it is widely recognized by industry also, whenever they are launching some online course to the students, that the design of the course must play as per the requirement of the student. So it affects the learning process also. Moving further, student motivation has been identified as a critical factor which can contribute in the learning outcome and student satisfaction. So students' motivation sometimes is discussed in relation with the self-regulated training learning also. So the researchers have used internal motivation and external motivation while defining student motivation. So they say internal motivation arises as a result of intrinsic gratification, enjoyment, difficulty associated with learning, while external motivation is more about, you can talk about, related to quantifiable goals and some rewards and recognition. So this is how student motivation is attached to the dependent variable, that is the learning outcome and this student satisfaction. Further, as we said, no matter which online learning platform mode we are using, it is whether it is a blended, whether it is live classes, whether it is pre-recorded session or blended. So instructor has a significant role to play. So instructor, when we talk about the instructor roles, so it speaks both formal and informal initiatives taken by the instructor to have a good discussion to execute the course as per the plan. So the researchers have explained the role of instructor in different manners, but in all such manners, the role of instructor is signified by all these researchers. So moving further, next important factor could be identified is the self-regulation. So self-regulated learners are active participants in their own learning process on metacognitive and behavioral levels. So this is how it is found that the students who are self-regulated, they are more satisfied and their learning outcome level is also better than those who are not self-regulated. So it is also found as an important or critical success factor in case of e-learning. So this way we could collate, if we, we made the summarization of the literature that the most of the authors have identified these five broader themes in which under which we can define different variables. Under all these themes, we can define different, you can say, items of factors or variables affecting the learning outcome and student satisfaction in an online learning. So research gap, and if coming to this part, if we have to justify the reason for current research, so we could see that researchers have examined these parameters affecting the learning outcome and student satisfaction, but no research has found a causal link between important success elements in e-learning setup, specifically with the graduate aptitude test. Further, all prior studies are confined to a student survey. No study has talked about what industry is looking for, or minimal or whatever we could find. So it was a partial kind of study which is seeking the opinion of industry people. So that is why this is the novelty of the paper also, that the current study has an expert-led research rather than a student-led. Although here I would also like to mention that the paper presented here is a part B of our complete research, because we started with the student-based survey also. We had some findings, which is again itself an extensive study. And then we shifted to looking at the what the industry is seeking. So the second part of paper is presented here. So that's why we are saying no other study has talked about how the people who are actually into making of products like this, so what they are seeking for out of these critical success factors. So moving ahead, talking about data inputs, as we said that the study is based upon expert opinion, and it was actually difficult to reach to these experts, but eventually one of the co-author is an industry person and she's in the same industry. So she could able to meet 12 experts, those who are at the strategic places, those who are at the, organizations like Princeton and edX, where they could interact and they could have this information for the further processing, that in their opinion, that what are out of this set of critical success factors identified through our previous study, that is student-based survey. So do they also have the same opinion, or they think that something else is considered while making a product for the students who are appearing for the graduate aptitude test and they're using e-learning platform. Since the study is based upon experts and the sample size seems to be small, so we used a multi-criteria decision modeling. So this is called DMATL. So this is decision making trial and evaluation laboratory. So this model is used for a small sample based on an expert opinion, where a causal relationship can be established to identify that which factor has more impact on the our dependent variable of the study. So coming to the result part, so since Renuka Sharma is the one who could do this whole analysis part, so maybe I'll lag if a technical question comes. So, but yes, I could understand the purpose of using DMATL and then how to interpret the results. So this is what I'm sharing with all of you. So the finding of the study says, DMATL gives you this matrix at the end, which is actually called the degree of influence. So where a factor having negative coefficient explains that this is the receiving factor, which means it is a dependent variable. So in case of DMATL, we just do the paired comparison. We are not making any comment that this is a dependent or independent variable. So through the data processing itself, the result indicates if some other factor would have negative coefficient, that would have also become a dependent variable. So it says that learning outcome is a dependent variable. Here, these highlighted coefficients are indicating that out of a list of these five factors, which is having highest importance in the opinion of experts, those who are the market strategists. So it indicates that course design has the highest importance in the opinion of experts. Instructor is the second one, and third is dialogue is the third one, and the least importance for them is the self-regulation, as long as learning outcome is concerned. Similarly, if we look at the results of that, which are the factors affecting student satisfaction, the findings of the DMATL indicated that in case of student satisfaction, the course design, instructor, and self-regulation are found most important, which are affecting the satisfaction of the student. And so these are the major outcomes of the study, I should say. So for learning outcome and student satisfaction, both instructor and course design found very, very important. For learning outcome, dialogue is the third important factor. And in case of student satisfaction, self-regulation is also found an important. Here I have mentioned top three. It doesn't mean others are not having an impact. They are found having a positive impact because the sign, their coefficient sign is positive. So, but these three are the most important. Indicating, if we talk about the implications of this study, it indicates that the instructor is very important. So we need to take care that the instructor is well-trained how to use online platform, because he is the one, he or she is the one who is designing the course structure also and executing the whole idea. So a good training given by organization to the instructor is required, and it will definitely add value to the course and more demand can be generated. Then course design, and after this other parameters are there. So this is what is mentioned in these lines. So that's all. These are some of the abridged references, selected references due to a shortage of space. So that's all I want to say, that specifically in the context of preparation of graduate aptitude test, from the point of view, what the strategists are thinking and what is there in their mind. So this is what we want to indicate through this paper. And this is something actually presented by Vanda in her one of the meeting also. So there, that was the beauty, a learning part for us that we could share it with the industry. Okay. Thank you.
Okay, Dr. Kiran, thank you. So a good presentation and very, very common, because especially when the pandemic has happened, most of the part it is either we are conducting classes on online mode, some of the universities on the blended mode as well, specifically in a few countries which are completely vaccinated. However, this particular research seems to be respondent, seems to be very highly focused. It doesn't have a large size, so it may have a data incoherency and estimation. But my question is that, the overall learning outcome will be an objective, and different factors of e-learning you have tried to figure out, but you have missed out on validation part, because any e-learning without validation, maybe with a certificate, maybe with the examinations, or maybe with a self-assessment, if the any course is there, offered on the e-learning platform without a validation method, it's very difficult to, finally relate to the overall learning outcome. So that is one of my observation, which I found that it is not there.
So here the submission is, as I said, this is part B of the paper, wherein all the, these are the factors on, checking the discriminant validity, then reliability. So everything was done in the student-based study on a large sample. Since expert-based study is always, unique, and we do not have large sample in that case. So that was the idea of adopting this methodology in this paper.
That's one part, that one suggestion from my side, that maybe
sure, sir.
Validation. And also, if you look at a study like this, It is the topic is too large, because graduate aptitude test has many components,
right?
And no course, one course cannot teach all components. So we should have taken only one component, maybe quantitative method, maybe reasoning, maybe logical conjecture, or also comprehension or English comprehension, what we say. So I think there are a lot of components. So to address to a particular component would have been better. However, the way you said that this is an ongoing work, so yes, these are all our suggestions, my suggestions.
Sure, sir. We are looking for this also, sir. We will definitely narrow down it further and look forward that if it is a case of subject specific, what can be considered.
Absolutely. Thank you. So now may I invite one, two questions from our colleagues here, fellow scholars connected. Okay. All right. So,
sir, I don't really have a question, but when ma'am was showing this, since I am also a teacher, and it seemed like an extremely important topic to me, that second slide you talked about some special method for small groups. Could you please elaborate on that? Because it seemed like a very effective point.
Sir, is it you're talking about that if a research is based upon expert opinion, then
no,
which
no,
matter?
No, madam. I'm not really talking about your research or your findings, but when you were showing the slide, I think in the second slide, there was a thing called small group.
Spoke. Yeah, sir, it was,
yes.
Spoke.
Yes,
sir.
Sir, what it is.
Sir, these are different types of courses we are offering on online platform, and the terminology used for that. So I was just talking about the
prevalent jargon. Is there anything special about small group teaching in online? Because right now, while we are not up to that graduate level difficulty, one batch of engineering, most of the classes that I get, online classes, they are like 50 to 60 students. And a big problem is to get any type of interaction out of them. It's a huge problem to get any type of, and as I saw that interaction, that dialogue was considered as one of the significant, very significant factors which came out of your analysis. And that quantitative result matches with what I also feel during actual application. So that is why I was asking, would this improve in some way if we had that thing you
yes,
called about smaller group, this SPS?
Yes, sir, definitely, sir. Whenever there is a specialized type of knowledge has to be inculcated. We are working in a niche setup. For example, maybe a new program, production engineering, who is considered by, who is opted by a small set of people who are require a special background. There you cannot run in a bigger setup. So there are certain courses which are suitable in case of small group study only. So there we want to mention this. For example, in industry setup, you want to train only three of the members working on a project, rather than everybody requires to attain that knowledge or upskilling. So that way I wanted to say, maybe in your class setup, 5 or 10 students, they need extra coaching.
That is true.
So that way we can go for it.
Okay, we run short of time now. So thank
yes,
you, Dr. Roop. But I think, what we use, a kind of breakout room. Breakout room is the only we can do in the online classes, which we use quite often with a small group, which is slightly not able to catch up with the class. Then we put them in a breakout room. Let the class continue with the normal self study on self kind of discussions.
Okay.
We attempt breakout room for 10 minutes and switch back.
I will try it, sir. Sir, thank you for the suggestion. I will try it out.
Different method is there. Thank you, Dr. Kiran, and I thank you, your co-authors as well. So keeping the time flow, we'll go to the paper code 2168, which is benchmarking efficient units of energy. 2168, benchmarking efficient units of energy index in DEA, data environment, probably is mentioning about analysis. And also TOPSIS. So may I invite Professor Vishal to present the paper?
I'm author, co-author of the paper, so I'll be presenting this paper too.
So how come these good people have outsourced this entire work to you? That's quite unfair, this morning. And that was a Sunday morning lady working so much.
So because of Sunday, the others are busy in their online other meetings, so I thought I'll take charge. That's why
So this is also
first,
your paper?
Okay. Yeah, oh, otherwise for the first paper, Vanna should have been there, because she's
so
the one who is more into, yes.
You are going to talk between learning outcome and data envelopment analysis.
So,
data envelopment analysis is a very interesting field, which is goes beyond Python, we all know. We are also trying to interestingly do some work in DEA Asia conference.
Okay.
Hopefully it comes to India.
So then I must accept it that if we talk about this specific paper, I must share the contribution of each and every author, because it's Vishal Vyas. He's a renowned faculty from ABBIIITM, and is a wonderful faculty in all research methods and data analysis. So he's always there to support us. And Dr. Renuka, she has collected all data. and I were more into making the flow of the paper and checking, sure, doing the proofreading. This is how we developed this.
But remember, time is only 20 minutes.
Sure, sir. I'll take
by 10 o'clock.
Sure, sir. Sure. Okay. So, as usual, yes. So, the title of the paper is Benchmarking Efficient Unit of Energy in the Company Under the Energy Index Using DAN TOPSIS. Energy companies are, these are the talk of the day. Climate change is talked about on all the world platforms. And here it is important to see that where we are moving. So let's talk some facts about the energy sector in India. So the power sector in India placed fourth out of 25 countries in the Asia Pacific region. And these days we are talking about the alternative sources of power rather than the energy based upon fossil fuels only. So here I also want to mention that because India is one of the country who has signed the Kyoto Agreement at Paris, wherein all the countries have committed to reduce the carbon emission so that by 2030, the carbon emission can be reduced to 2% level. So all the countries are actively in the implementation of their alternative energy projects. And maybe in the future, this sector will be contributing in, showing the overall performance of the economy also. So the sector is very important because if you look at the energy sector, which is composed of power companies, electricity supply companies and all, which are heavily subsidized by the government. So these are well regulated also. So like pharmaceutical, like banks, so energy sector is another sector which is well regulated and which is always catching the importance, and maybe in next decade will be of the performance of these companies when they'll be completing the gestation period and the energy companies will be falling in the category of generating profit and revenues to the stakeholders. So these are some underlying facts which motivated us to pursue this topic. So what the extant literature is talking about this. So we have broadly categorized these studies under different headings so that we can justify why we took this topic. So this slide talks about the papers which have highlighted the importance of energy sector in an economy. So talking about papers coming from Australia, China. So these papers are clearly mentioned that yes, and the alternative energy will be the future of the country, and these are going to play a significant role, and the government's role is going to be increased in the implementation of these projects. Other category of literature talking about the financial viability, since I'm a faculty in finance, so I'm more concerned about what are the things which are affecting the financial viability of companies in the energy sector. As I mentioned earlier also, that most of the energy sector companies are heavily subsidized, but it cannot go forever. So it is important to ensure that these companies become financial viable. So some of the researchers have tried to explore that what is the status of financial performance of these companies, for which they have used different indicators like financial ratio, return on sales, cash flow, return on investment, return on equity. And similarly, because number of companies are less in comparison to FMCG, cement or other sectoral based analysis. So most of the studies are again based upon a little small sample rather than a large sample. So in continuation with the same, there are some more studies by Wang 2010, Zhu et al. 2019 and others. So they have also examined the performance of these energy companies and try to see how their carbon emission is affecting the overall economic growth. Now, as I said, I'm more concerned about studying the financial viability of these companies. So what are the financial indicators taken by these past researchers? So through these studies, I have tried to showcase that, yes, these are the indicators. More or less many indicators are common because in usually in finance, we can always find out 10 to 15 indicators which have which are giving you a clear indication whether the company is in a financial sound position or not. So yes, some studies based upon Ghana. So one is these are important to mention. So what they could find that the poor performance of these companies, these projects have a heavy cost to the economy. So which is further resulting into more financial problems at the economy level. So because heavy investment is involved in all types of energy projects. So there is, we can say, heavy energy cost. So it is important that after some point in time, these projects become financially viable. Otherwise, there will be a situation of financial distress at a large level. So to conclude, yes, as I mentioned that, yes, this sector is important considering the national policy and the global community's commitment to reduce the carbon emission. Naturally, this sector is going to grow further, but their financial viability is important for the sustainability of these projects. So it justifies the idea of checking the financial viability. Actually, the purpose here is to see that out of a given set of, because as we said, India has a remarkable role in Asia Pacific region, and of course it is increasing at the global level also. So Indian energy sector definitely going to play a big role in the overall development and growth of the country. So we want to see out of energy companies, which are the companies to whom we can call that, yes, these are the benchmarks, so that other companies can also follow the practices followed by these benchmark units. Okay, so broadly there are two objectives. One is to identify the benchmark energy company out of companies listed in Nifty Energy Index, and once we have identified the most efficient unit, if there are more than one unit, we want to see which is which can be ranked 1, 2, or 3. So meeting the to meet the objective of the study, as we mentioned, so we took the companies listed under the Nifty Energy Index. So these are 10 companies, and data from 2017 to 20 was taken. So when we say energy index, so it is a composition of companies in the field, in the business of gas, petroleum, power. And these are the 10 companies which come under this energy index. So these studies have been further considered for the data analysis purpose to check their financial viability, to identify the most efficient unit, and those which are the efficient units, so can we rank them? If yes, then what is that ranking? So to measure the technical efficiency, the popular technique is data envelopment analysis is used, and to make the ranking, there is another prominent technique called TOPSIS that is used here. So the literature, we have mentioned some literature here, so which is justifying the, or which is supporting the financial variables can be used for the meeting the objective to check the financial performance of these company. So usually current asset, current liability, fixed asset, fixed liability, net asset, sales volume, these highlighted indicators are used by most of the studies to examine the financial performance. Since we want to know the efficient units, and the sample size seems to be small, and for the application of DA, so we need to ensure that the variables taken as input and output should meet the sample size criteria of DEA, because we couldn't go beyond 10 number of units. So somehow we could shortlist five major indicators, of which one is the output variable, that is net profit margin. And we took four input variables, that is fixed asset turnover ratio, debt equity ratio, current ratio, and interest coverage ratio. Although there could be more, as I said, the sample size is small, so we couldn't afford more number of output and more number of input variables. So the most commonly variables, financial variables used by the researchers, so through that we finalize these variables. So now the question is DA is a right technique to use? Yes, it is used extensively. So we have a support of literature also. It is used across different sectors and across different countries also. So it is used in, you know, some finding the efficiency of railway system, then green cars project. You can find in aluminium industry, some cement industries examples are there. We have example for use of this in petrochemical, non-life insurance. Many examples are there where this technique is used for finding the efficiency of banks. So this way we can say, yes, it is justifiable to use this technique, although there are advancements too. But we have kept the scope to the basic model of DEA here. And yes, TOPSIS is also used as a measure to rank the units in different sectors. So a few studies are there which have used the integrated model. So there are examples where TOPSIS and Promethe is used, where AHP and Fuzzy TOPSIS is used. So we have also tried to make a, you know, integrated approach where we are finding the efficient units first, then we are trying to give them ranking, right? So after the implementation of data envelopment technique, we could find out of given 10 units, only 3 units were found as the efficient unit because their score was exceeding the standard coefficient 1. So GAIL, ONGC and Power Grid, these 3 were found more efficient. It doesn't mean that only 3 have profits and the others do not have profit. So maybe others firms are into profits, but considering the relationship of input and output variables. So because in DEA, we calculate the average score and try to see how many are above average, but above average also doesn't mean they are the most efficient units. So these are the actual results we could see. The mean score we could find 0.667, but in this mean score, we could find 5 units falling. Find this GAIL, NTPC, ONGC, Power Grid Corporation of India, and Reliance Industries. Although these 5 units have more than average score, but even having 5 units having more than average score, only 3 units were found efficient units. That is GAIL, ONGC, and Power Grid Corporation of India. It indicates, so if we have to summarize the results of DA, sir, what is the meaning of efficient units? So these are the units which are best in the best way, able to optimize their resources, and they could result into best, you can say, financial performance. So efficient units once identified indicates that other units or other DMUs should also follow the practices. They should see that what is missing at their end and what is existing at the end of the efficient units, so that they can also fall under the category of efficient units. So now, because we could find that there are 3 units which are found efficient, GAIL, ONGC, and Power Grid, then we wanted to know that out of 3, which one is the best. So we applied TOPSIS for this, and the ranking we could find that the Power Grid, GAIL, and ONGC, this was the ranking. These scores are based upon results of TOPSIS. So higher the score, higher is the ranking. If all energy companies are trying to improvise, so they can look forward the performance of these 3 companies, and out of these 3, Power Grid seems to be the best one. And this is how they can improvise their financial performance. So there are some studies which are, you know, supporting these results also. Because in case of energy companies, less number of evidences are there. And in case of India, we do not find much evidences talking like this. But yes, in one of the study, we could find that, yes, it must be here, where ONGC was found doing really good. Yes, it was by Saxena et al., where it was found ONGC was the most efficient unit. But yes, here seems that the ranking has fallen. So this is important because our purpose is financial viability of energy companies must be ensured. And gradually government should withdraw the subsidy because this subsidy-based business may not order.
Okay, Dr. Kiran, yes. I think we come to an end now.
Right.
We're out of time, so please, right. I think conclude. I think that's okay.
That's all from my side, sir. Yes, scope lies because there is a possibility of conducting study on large sample, so we can include more number of companies. And last year was pandemics, there is a change in the, you know, company's mindset also. So I think the field, current field, has a good scope for future research also.
Thank you. So now may I invite all the colleagues here, you know, to ask any question, or if you have quick one, two interface suggestions, you may. So we are running almost neck to neck with the time, but still. Okay. All right. Seems to be that, you know, the people have understood your propositions in this paper using basically DEA, data envelopment analysis, and also TOPSIS you use, quite interesting. Usually these tools are, you know, of late more common now. So now in this case, energy efficiency units, what you use about, you know, and also you have tried to link it back to the public sector units. You know, there's a cost of subsidy also. Probably we believe that subsidy is incoming as a part of revenue to any corporate, but there's a cost of subsidy, managing subsidy. So this is just a session from my side. Maybe you look at what is the cost of subsidies, you know, either from the central government or maybe the corporations, how they have managed this subsidy, and whether it is in line with the international call that every organization, if you are efficient, work. If you are not efficient, well, let it be privatized, you know, or let it be managed by multinational companies, if it is so. That's interesting. But thank you. This is very good paper, especially with the DEA coming here.
Thank
so
you.
Now, friends, we go to 2169, which is about brand, you know, structure and financial statements. This is the broader area by our paper presenter is Dr. Deepika and her co-authors. Dr. Deepika, are you connected?
Yes, sir, yes.
Oh, okay, please go ahead.
Is my screen visible, sir?
Yes, we can see that.
Okay, thank you so much. Very good morning to all of you from Deepika Arora Madan, research scholar at Chitkara University. On behalf of my co-authors, that is Dr. Kiran Mehta and Dr. Renuka Sharma, I'm delivering this presentation on the topic.
Can you be a little louder, madam?
Am I audible now?
Yeah, perfect.
Okay. So I'm going to discuss the title of the paper, that is Board Structure and Financial Statement Frauds, a Systematic Review and Research Agenda. This is a review paper. Just a minute. My screen is not moving.
Maybe right. You can stop sharing and share again. It's not moving because there are 31 slides, quite large.
Is the second slide visible, sir? Concept of fraud? Okay, sir. Thank you. So let us first understand the concept of fraud. What exactly is fraud? According to Association of Certified Fraud Examiners, fraud is the use of one's occupation for personal enrichment through deliberate misuse or misapplication of the employing organization resources or assets. A fraud in itself is a very vast field, actually. Our presentation is basically focused on the particular element of fraud, that is the financial statement fraud. In view of Associated Chambers of Commerce and Industry of India, that is ASOCHAM, they are of the opinion that financial statement frauds is a deliberate misapplication, misinterpretation, falsification, misrepresentation, or you can say the omission of financial statement data for the purpose of misleading the reader and creating a false impression of an organization's financial strength. It definitely includes techniques such as manipulating the liabilities, overstatement of assets, sales or profit, manipulation of expenditure, improper revenue recognition, or inappropriate or incorrect vouching. It is worth mentioning here that most of these financial statement frauds occur with the participation, knowledge, and approval of top management teams, including the CEOs, CFOs. So this kind of fraud can be called as occupational fraud. So this is the concept, occupational fraud, that is to be focused when we are discussing the concept of financial statement frauds. According to a report, it has been said that financial statement frauds is amongst the category of occupational frauds, which occurs in the least number of cases, that is just around 10%. But the loss suffered by these 10% cases is the maximum amongst the other categories of occupational frauds. We can see that the slide definitely shows asset misappropriation is in 86% cases, whereas financial statement frauds, which we are focusing, is generally only 10% cases. But if we compare the losses of these types of frauds, the losses are maximum in case of this type of fraud. So why do occupational frauds happen? Why did they occur? The question arises here, what is the reason behind these occupational frauds? Why the persons who are considered as the caretakers, or we can say the well-wishers of the company, why they commit fraud? These key officials holding decision-making positions within an organization may be motivated to manipulate financial reports whenever they find that there is an opportunity, because financial statement reports that reflect their management ability can directly affect their personal wealth, and the pressure to maintain the company's performance in order to maintain company position in the market and attracting finances, which is rational on their part, and thereby this involves agency cost, of course. So this is a figure that exactly depicts the reason for these financial statement frauds. This fraud triangle is given by Sir Donald Cressey, who aptly describes the fraud triangle depicting pressure, opportunity, and rationalization behind the financial statement frauds. Here, pressure motivates or pressurizes a fraudster to commit such behavior for the desired benefit. Such pressure may be the financial condition or maybe the desire to get something. The opportunity refers to the conditions when the fraudster thinks that the risk of being caught are remote. And the rationalization is the behavior of that internal perpetrator, that whatever he does as a part of fraudulent action is rational, and he definitely has a proper justification in this regard. So now you can see these are the top 10 scandals in the past decades, which are called cases of financial statement frauds. These are the cases of financial statement frauds. First, we have a waste management scandal. It was a waste management company in USA, which is a publicly traded company. It committed fraud in the form of fake earnings. And of course, owner and former CEO were held guilty of such fraud. Then we have Enron scandal. It was an energy company that overstated its earnings to hide billions of dollars of bad debts, causing losses of around $74 billion. And in this case also, current and former CEO were held guilty for such fraud. Next, we have WorldCom scandal. Again, a telecom company in US which showed false operating expenses in their financial statement to hide the decreasing earnings and inflated their assets, causing loss of $180 billion to investors. Then we have Tyco scandal, a blue chip company of US where theft of $150 million by CEO and CFO hidden by inflating assets. It was noticed by investigation through SEC, that is Securities and Exchange Commission. Then we have HealthSouth scandal, healthcare company from US that also inflated earnings. And this company had 36 counts of accounting frauds as revealed by SEC. Then we have Freddie Mac scandal, a home loan mortgage company reported understated earnings by CFO, American International Group, that is AIG, an insurance company, understated earnings by CEO, CFO, and COO. Lehman Brothers scandals, largest investment banks that hidden $50 billion making use of accounting scandal, and Bernie Madoff scandal that is committed by a stockbroker in US who utilized the Ponzi scheme and committed financial statement fraud. Then we also have some cases from India also, financial statement frauds. Satyam scandal 2009, an IT service from India inflated its revenue by ₹15,000 crores, that is equal to $1.5 billion. An owner, accountant, and second in command were caught during investigations by CBI. And second is Rico India scandal in 2016. It was a company engaged in IT services, which is an Indian division of Japanese multinational Rico Global, shown unsupported out-of-the-box adjustments to net sales, expenses, assets, and liabilities. Now, is there any need for development of corporate regulations? Of course, yes. To control financial statement fraud, we need some regulations also. The consequences of serious corporate scandals, there seems to be the need of overseeing the practices adopted by the corporates and management through stronger control and strict mechanisms that monitor them. With the increase in the number of corporate scandals, the concern regarding the financial statement increased amongst shareholders, which required the imposition of definitely the governance standards. And for this purpose, codes of corporate governance are introduced, and also they are revised time to time. So this is called corporate governance, which is of utmost importance in today's industry. The term corporate governance, it's a gamut of activities causing direct or indirect influence on the financial health of any organization. It may be termed as a synonym of honesty. It is a combination of legal and regulatory framework, monitoring and internal control, transparency and accountability, policies and procedures, and most importantly, board of directors and committees, because these are the persons who are in charge of, to oversee the activities of the corporation. These persons are responsible. So corporate governance is a structure in the process of monitoring executive performance, ensuring accountability of management to shareholder, motivating the management towards creating value for the stakeholders, and protecting the interest of other stakeholders, including the local community. So the origin of corporate governance dates back to 1970s, when private companies were discovered to have been involved in politics through illegal financing of political parties in the USA. So discussions on corporate governance refer to these three documents, namely the Cadbury report, OECD reports, that is Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development. They have given different guidelines from 1999, 2004 and 2015, and Sarbanes-Oxley Act 2002. The principles behind these regulations are based on the rights of shareholders, interest of stakeholders, ethical behaviors, roles and responsibility of board, and disclosure and transparency. So these things are highlighted in these reports. So we also have agency theory. So agency theory, one of the most relevant theory under corporate governance, is the agency theory, which says that directors are appointed to oversee the activities of the managers and control them. Of course, they are the person, those who can oversee and control the activities that is going on in the business. The financial statements to which the principals here are the shareholders, and agents are directors. So these directors are the agents on behalf of principals. The principals can get information about the operations of the business through the financial statements, of course, and board of directors as agents are given full charge to control the malpractices in the financial statements so that stakeholders may get truthful information. The director's role is to oversee the financial statements, and their inability to do so involves the risk of unethical behavior, thereby increasing the agency cost for shareholders. And failure in this financial reporting is largely being blamed upon these weak internal controls, you can say. And worries about these accounting problems are widely cited as a reason for the stock market slump that followed these scandals. So what if the agency theory fails? Look at this figure, which represents the failure of agency theory. Now this figure represents when weak internal controls, which depict failure of agency, wherein directors are unable to oversee or supervise, or you can say control, the financial statements, fraudulent activities, resulting in manipulation of earnings, of course, and giving rise to stock market slump, and definitely the firm would get into bankruptcy in this case. So what are the efforts that are done to corporate governance measures that are done to control or prevent, you can say, financial statement frauds? First, we have Cadbury Committee that was formed in 1992 in England, King's Committee in South Africa, Hampel 1998, OECD principles already discussed, 1998, and Sarbanes-Oxley Act 2002. We also have Indian Codes and Committees available. Basically, Companies Act 1956 was the first document which mentioned the corporate governance in India. Thereafter, CII, that is Confederation of Indian Industry, released Desirable Corporate Governance, a code. It was a desirable kind of thing. And in the year 1998, it is to be applied on listed companies, which detailed its provision into various sections. It specifically insisted on providing the annual reports of the companies that abide with the corporate governance code should contain a chapter to disclose corporate governance practices followed by the company, mainly focusing on board of directors, their composition, independence, meeting attendance, etc. But this desirable code of corporate governance, that is CII, that formed that desirable corporate, which was drafted by CII, it didn't produce the effective results. The expected improvement was not seen. And for this purpose, a formal and comprehensive attempt was done by SEBI by constituting a committee on corporate governance under the chairmanship of Kumar Mangalam in the year 1999. They felt that under Indian conditions, a statutory rather than a voluntary code would be introduced, would be more purposive and meaningful, of course. The report provided by Kumar Mangalam was considered by SEBI and was divided into the recommendations into two parts, that is the mandatory requirements and the non-mandatory, as are adopted by the SEBI in the year 2000. In the year 2002, after reported accounting scandals and introduction of Sarbanes-Oxley Act in US, the government of India also appointed a committee under the chairmanship of Naresh Chandra to focus on auditor and client relationship. Further, in the year 2003, SEBI appointed under the chairmanship of Narayan Murthy to introduce new and tighter rules to be followed by the Indian companies to fulfill the requirements of foreign investors and for the purpose of attracting foreign investments to the secondary market. In the year 2005, J.J. Irani Committee was formed to recommend simplified modern law for the management of companies. And another committee in the year 2017 was introduced by SEBI by Mr. Uday Kotak in June 2017. This committee offered the strong recommendations for enhancing the efficiency of norms of corporate governance for Indian listed companies and aligning the corporate governance practices with the global best practices and, of course, keeping in view the Indian scenario. So we can see time and again, India has tried to apply various policies relating to corporate governance for the purpose of maintaining standards of corporate governance. So what do we do to control financial statement frauds to follow corporate governance regulations for the purpose of smooth conduct of corporate activities and controlling the financial frauds to happen in an organization? There is a need to follow the regulations of corporate governance. And for this purpose, an oversight body is definitely required to be accountable for the purpose of accounting, reporting and auditing process to ensure communication to the users are transparent and with integrity. Each element of board affects the internal controls. Supervision and control are necessitated to be done by these responsible authorities so as to fulfill the problems that arise in agency theory. The concept of corporate governance is not confined to a single country, but there are many countries which have been following the practices of corporate governance for the purpose of controlling these financial statement frauds. The countries like US, New Zealand, Bangladesh, Nigeria, Portugal, Italy, Malaysia, India, Egypt, Australia, UK, Saudi Arabia, Romania, China, Pakistan, Kazakhstan, and many more. So actually, the board composition is a major component to reduce agency problems. So it includes elements relating to board structure, like board independence. It is believed that the potential divergence between management and shareholders reduces with the inclusion of independent directors to the board. And the presence of independent directors is found to be an effective corporate governance mechanism that lead to better supervision of board effectiveness. Researchers have found that financial statement frauds decreases and information quality definitely gets increased with the high percentage of outside directors to the board. And in order to reduce the agency cost, the agency theory also lays stress on the majority of independent directors on the board. So there are authors like Yang and Buckland who didn't find any evidence that independent director play a role in deterring fraudulent practices, but many of the researchers are focusing that independent directors have a major role to play in controlling the financial statement frauds. Next, we have board duality. Board duality here, we are referring to the role of chairperson and CEO. When it is managed by the single person, it is called board duality. And board duality shows higher probability of earning manipulation and negatively related to sustainability performance as combined role. If the person is holding both the position, it results in ethical need of self-monitoring, which does not always work and can definitely lead to abuse of power. So some authors believe that board duality is associated with poor quality of financial information. The roles, if they are separated, make the financial information rather more relevant. Next, we have board meetings. In papers relating to board meetings, it was found that there is a significant influence between frequency of board meetings and corporate fraud. The director should meet regularly in order to discuss the issues regarding the corporation activities. A high percentage of board meetings shows that directors know about the corporate activities and are able to monitor the implementation of strategy in the corporation and are aware of companies' activities. Moreover, it is also true that meeting involves huge costs and the director's remuneration too, but still, the board meetings are positively related to firm's performance. Next is board size. By referring to the board size as a number of directors on the board, it implies effectiveness of the board of directors and the efficiency in dealing with the operations of the company affairs. Many previous researchers find number of directors as relevant factors in effective decision making. Larger be the board size means more specialist in the board, enhancing the ability of the board as a whole. But some researchers are also focusing that smaller boards are more effective as they have more communication with each other. SEBI Lauder, that is Listing Obligations and Disclosure Requirements 2015, has not highlighted this concept. They are only stressing upon that not only the number, but sufficient number of directors with diverse backgrounds and skills should be available to fulfill the functions and obligations. Then we have professional expertise. The varied sets and expertise is imperative in the complex and competitive world. So it is necessitated, of course, that the board of directors should have the requisite skills to meet out the growing demands and the ever challenging demands of the business. But the amendment that is proposed by SEBI under Schedule 5 regarding the submission of annual report describes the skills of directors requires a chart or a matrix setting out the skills and expertise, competing, specifying the list of core skills or competencies identified by the board of directors as required in the context of business for it to function effectively and for those available with the board, and names of the directors who are having or possessing such relevant skills should be definitely shown under their annual reports. Next, we have board age. Very small number of researchers focused on the demographic profile such as age of directors as a technique to corporate governance practices. According to a research by Chang and Chen, the average age of directors in the board carries importance. Older directors are more often experienced and capable to have more to lose if they fall in their monitoring duties. Therefore, it is expected that they have a strong motivation for monitoring CEOs of the company very closely so that frauds can be minimized. And older directors have been exposed to traditional culture and customs for longer, which usually foster their ethical conduct. They're more likely to make ethical decisions, of course. Then we have board gender diversity. The other demographic characteristic that such that it should be the presence of women director in the board, which is also carrying the relevance. And moreover, I would like to mention here is that in May 2019 also, SEBI has penalized 72 companies for not fulfilling the requirements of board composition, including the appointment of women director to the board. So it is considered utmost necessary and a mandatory requirement that a women on the board should be included. If they are not having any women director to the board, they will be definitely penalized. So Kotak Committee of Corporate Governance, as constituted under the chairmanship of Uday Kotak, has also highlighted the mandatory requirement of women to the board. At least one women director for the top 500 listed entities is necessary by April 2019 and for top 1,000 companies by April 2020. Next, last, we have audit committees. One of the major components of corporate governance, that is the audit committee, provide critical insight of companies' financial reporting and auditing process. The task of audit committee is critical as regards it is to be blamed upon in case of any discrepancy, whether it is a case of management override or anything else. So the audit committee needs to be extra careful to watch and detect each and every aspect of financial statement that may mislead or manipulate the financial statements of an entity. So these are some of the actions that taken by the regulatory bodies. These are some of the suggestions or principles that are made mandatory. So these regulatory bodies continuously supervise the activities of the company. Like I said, SEBI is penalizing those companies who are not following the regulatory practices. So they are continuously supervising the activities of the company so that they may follow corporate governance practices properly. So this one is the clause 49, which is a very important clause to corporate governance in India. So this clause 49 says, this is on the recommendations offered by Kumar Mangalam committee. He suggested clause 49 to the corporate governance structure. SEBI issued directions to stock exchanges to insert this clause 49 called corporate governance, which contains 8 sections and listing requirements in this regard. The mandatory requirements, of course, focus on composition of the board, formation of board committee and remuneration committee. And the disclosure of each one of these mandatory under separate section with detailed compliance report on code of corporate governance to be provided by the company in its annual report. Now we have a country-based study on board structure. Take a minute. So this is a country-based structure of board. Almost all the countries of the world have faced such type of internal frauds, as already said. These are happening in almost all of the organization across the world. I have come across 137 studies on corporate governance dealing with board structure, and I found 65 studies as relevant on the topic, which I have found that India, Nigeria, Malaysia, US, China, UK, Bangladesh, Romania, Egypt, New Zealand, Ghana, Brazil, Portugal, Spain, Canada, each one of the studies focusing on these elements of board structure. So this is about the details and the authors who have done research on corporate governance regarding this thing. Next, we have elements of corporate governance and relating study. Each of the element has been studied. In this case, like board independence, board duality, board structure, board meetings, board diversity, these have been studied, the corporate governance mechanism. Many of the authors are saying that probability, in case of non-executive director, or you can say independent directors, probability of restatement is lower in companies whose board or audit committees have an independent director with financial expertise, of course. So these are the studies. I'm not going to through all of them as due to limitation of time. So I have mentioned all of them on the basis of independence, board size, board duality, board meetings. Each one of the elements has been discussed. Right. So next we have year-wise data on board structure. So I have started doing research on this thing. I have collected papers from the year 2004 to 2020, wherein many of the authors have given their suggestions. The list starts with the year 2004 and it ends with 2020. Of course, we have papers relating to 2021 also, but I don't find relevant for this purpose. Quantitative research on earnings management. So this comprises of the sample and the findings that different papers have given, different authors have given their presentation, their opinions regarding different elements of board structure. So each one of them have their own observation in this regard. Next, we have the limitations. So corporate governance is a list of activities and involves various elements, some of which are discussed here. There may be many more elements also which can be studied to gain the in-depth knowledge of this concept. The present paper has only discussed a few elements like board independence, board size, board duality, board meetings, board members' professional expertise, age and gender of board members and audit committees. There are more areas like ownership structure, recruitment process, culture of organization, tone from the top and remuneration committee, which can further be explored in this direction, of course. So conclusion from my part is that overall, all we can say that corporate governance is an efficient measure to control fraudulent financial statements. The analysis done by Hildar also supports on Indian industry provides evidence that corporate governance is influential and it is a long-lasting concept for those firms which aspire to enhance their performance. The composition of board has significant impact on likelihood of financial fraudulent statements. And the board of directors supervises and manages this to solve agency conflicts. And the presence of independent, or we can say the non-executive directors, the separation of roles of chairman and CEO, that means not following the board duality, the frequency of board meetings, the presence of experienced and professional directors to the board and the audit committees, the independent audit committees, of course, all these elements serve as a shield to prevent any fraud in financial statements. And also it is a solution to agency conflicts. So these are the references for my paper. And thank you from my side. Any questions, please?
That's very interesting, really. But the paper was very, very good and very informative, very structured. And as well as you have tried to, you know, look at many, many factors. But, you know, before I invite questions and from all our friends connected this morning, there's one, two question from my side.
Jeez.
You know, in the corporate governance, you know, trying to minimize the frauds or also trying to, trying to prevent the frauds, you know, in the longer term or the shorter term.
Yeah. Yeah.
So now there are two, you know, especially after MCA 21 project that was implemented by Government of India, which is, you know, the very famous MCA 21 projects and the commissions you referred, there is a structural part of avoidance of the fraud. There is a system part of avoidance of the fraud. And also, if you look at there is a strategic part of awareness of the fraud. So now what Government of India has done that, you know, that no company who has a current account in the bank and has run an overdraft, you know, or taken a loan linked to that account can open any other current account in any other bank. This is very recent. I think your paper might be over by the time this policy came. So I think maybe as an extension, so this will change the way we carry out the study, because now we have to see that the system part will play a major role, that will the corporations find another way of trying to bypass the system approach of preventing frauds, because no company, otherwise the company used to do, they will open a current account, run an overdraft or the loan, and they will simply open another account and start getting the revenue from the sales in the new bank account while the parent bank is still waiting for the money to come.
Correct.
And to recover their loan. So this was a systemic gap which Government of India has done. About independent directors, did you find in your, just out of interest, I just wish to know, did you find any relation with some companies where more of women directors, you know, on the board, yeah. independent women directors had less reporting of such instances?
I found that the women boards are particularly doing well as compared to the companies which is having the complete set of male directors. They are performing definitely good, and moreover, women are not at all focused that all of the directors should on the board should be women. It is not at all said that it is said that at least one woman to the board should be there, so that. As women are having less attitude of accepting the discrepancies in the financial statement frauds, they are most likely that they are not contributing to the frauds, of course, and they are highlighting the fraudulent practices that are going on in the concern. They are not accepting those fraudulent financial statements. It has been seen in various papers that women boards are basically performing well.
Okay, and also could you get a time to look into that, how much independence have been given to the independent directors? Sometime in the board meetings, you know, have you been able to interact and do a focus group interview with some of the board members, especially independent directors in the board?
No, sir, this study is basically secondary in nature, and I don't have any interaction with any of them.
Okay, sure, thank you. So now I'll request all the friends here, if any one, two questions or suggestions, if you wish to ask Dr. Deepika, please go ahead. Okay. Any question from Dr. Arun? Okay, now let me invite any question from Dr. Sunita. Dr. Sunita from Dubai. Are you connected? Dr. Sunita from Dubai, are you connected?
Yeah, I'm sorry, I was on mute. I'm not a finance person, but I do like the fact that they're going to be women representing on boards. And I think that's good because there is a glass ceiling for women in all areas. And it would be good to have women, more women being represented. So that was something that resonated with me.
Great. And that was my way of checking whether you have joined or no. Because
yes, I understand. I did get that.
Welcome to this. Okay, Dr. Arun, anything from your side? Sorry, Dr. Arun, my mistake.
Sir, that current account idea was really great. I had no idea that such a thing happened. That was an amazing point, I thought.
That is the magic of Prime Minister Modi, you know, it comes.
That's such a peculiar way of doing fraud. But very simple way of defrauding that parent bank. It's not very complicated way. It's a very simple way, but it had to be stopped. So that's a great thing.
Now they are also closing many multiple accounts. So if any corporate has a current account, obviously they will have a current account. And in any way, if anywhere even 100 rupees loan has been taken or overdraft has been ever taken, you know, RBI is asking that companies and the banks to close all other accounts. They can only have one account.
Sir, there was recently this information, actually I do not have any in-depth knowledge of this, that happened with those online platforms. They were told that actually their own subsidiary companies were the primary sellers, and they were forced to say that no, you cannot keep more than 25% inventory under your own subsidiary company. It's like there is this type of a, I think they used the word on the media, they used the word something called shell game, like holding company and under them their company. So the parent company cannot be caught for fraud. It is the subsidiary company who is doing the thing, but the parent company is benefiting.
You are right, because that was a captive holding company, and the captive holding company, not an Indian company, but look at Amazon. It is in the courts right now in India, primarily because of that. Because they had open, and it's very common, hundreds of subsidiaries. You divide your stake into 100 of subsidiaries. You dilute your equity. You do the reverse swap ratio. And finally, they mitigate the frauds component among 100 subsidiary. And yes, investigating agency are just left to find for themselves whom to catch.
Yes, sir. They're basically, they are dividing the responsibility, but capturing the profit. Something.
Yeah, this is there. But actually, one more thing is happening about internationally. If you look at linkage, that is still not possible to curb, because one can simply have a subsidiary company abroad. And so unless the whole, you know, the major players in the world, economic powers, come together and enforce, economic frauds are very difficult to stop. But yes, India has moved a bit faster. So thank you, friends. I think I'm tempted to request Professor P.T. Anantha. Professor P.T., anything from your side?
Mr. Suryansh, if I understand correctly, I just want to add my small bit on this. You know, this Dhirubhai Ambani's companies, I'm not sure whether we are talking about the same thing. He had a network of subsidiaries, which actually could not pinpoint who the owner was. So are we talking of something similar to that?
No, they are talking about, this paper was about, you know, corporate frauds and role of independent directors and basically board in mitigating the frauds and trying to prevent the frauds. And it was not only one company in India. If you look at, there are many companies which are not listed in the Indian, you know, stock exchanges, but their revenue and the worth size is almost, you can say, almost $1 billion. There are many, many such companies, especially in the logistics arm, distribution channel management, you can say contract manufacturers, their turnover is something like that, close to $1 billion, even more, but they have not listed.
So yeah, so we have a lot of those companies abroad. We have a lot of those companies based in the UK who are billionaires, who are like top 500 billionaires in the world, who are not listed, who are private companies and who have a lot of subsidiaries, because we have those companies operating in Dubai, and who I know personally two of those, and who don't like to be listed. And we never understand who the beneficiaries are, final beneficiaries, and they run based on trust funds.
Absolutely, you are right. And this is also here. But this work by Professor Deepika is very interesting. And I am sure this is a larger part of her work, because it is one part she has studied. So now coming to paper code 2172, I'll be inviting Dr. Sunita, which is already there, connected here. It's about H theory framework, systematic review of happiness through cross-cultural perspective. Very interesting topic.
I guess this is a commonly arching topic for most of us, because happiness is a very common thing for most of us. It impacts all of us. So this is a paper that is currently under peer review. So a lot of things in this paper I may not be able to share.
Fair enough. Absolutely fine. And Dr. Sunita, may I take just 10 seconds? And that is precisely the reason to increase the happiness, Professor Shiv Agarwalji keeps all the conferences on Sunday. So you are relaxed and there's no hurry. All right.
Okay. So this is a paper that is took us 2 years to collate data. And this paper is a collaboration with a student from Columbia University. She is currently doing her PhD, and myself. And we had a third author, but she kind of had to look at other projects. So it's two of us who were involved in this study. So the concept of happiness, as all of you know, is very popular, and not just popular, but is required. And it's required across all cultures, and it has multiple definitions. So if we try to pinpoint what is happiness, we really cannot pinpoint what is happiness. But in recent years, there's been a shift also culturally, also country-wise, on measuring, moving from measuring economic production to measuring happiness as an indicator of social development across nations. If you look at Sweden, if you look at Finland, if you look at happy nations, and even if you look at UAE, that's becoming, like, trying to become a very happy country. And countries and governments are giving more priority to happiness, and they are using that as a measuring tool to economic growth and economic development, which is a good shift. Now, happiness, if you look at literature, has been conceptualized as an evolution of life, or evaluation of life as a whole. So it's a holistic development of life. It's also regarded as a state of mind. How is one feeling? It's also a psychological state of being. And it's also a positive indicator of how one's health is, not just physical health, but also mental health. And it's completely synonymous with subjective well-being. So there are various definitions of happiness. The H theory framework is an integrated framework that has been trademarked by the Dubai Economic Department. Now, it's an equifinality development model, which means that all definitions of happiness lead to the final conclusion. And happiness can be universally conceptualized across cultures, across countries, and across diverse backgrounds. So what does this equifinality model comprise of? It basically comprises of three main contributing factors that influence happiness. So these three can be kind of themed into three areas, or we call them dimensions, which are health, hope, and harmony. Now, when we say health, we speak about mental health, we speak about physical health, and we speak about social well-being. So kind of when we kind of put them into categories, or we try to put them into definitions, it would be head, which stands for mental health, and or a healthy mind, or heart, which stands for emotional health, and then hand, which depicts physical health or a healthy body. Now, hope concept is conceptualized as something that is innately in every human being, for a desire to do good, which is a belief, with a belief that it is attainable. And it is divided into a horizon with which you have a focus to do good, a holistic life balance. It requires life balance, sustainable, and a compassion. You cannot try to have hope, which is positive, without compassion and caring for your fellow human beings. And lastly, this dimension of harmony, which is basically life balanced with one another around the world. So you cannot have harmony for yourself if there's no harmony at home, and there's no harmony with your environment, and if there's no harmony with your heritage, with your past, because if there's no harmony with your past, there cannot be a harmony with your present and your future. So this model was, the H theory framework was put together by Kanakri and Kanakri in 2011, and they actually trademarked it. So what we've done is we took this framework and we tried to validate it through our study. What did we do? We took this H theory framework and we looked at 80 years of research. So we looked at research starting from 1930 to current, to 2021. We looked at 5 databases, AP PsycNet, EBSCO, Academic, Business, Google Scholar, Project MUSU. And we chose about 2,675 papers. And when we looked at these 2,675 papers across these 5 databases, definitely we found duplicates, which means certain papers were existing in more than one database. So after we removed the duplicates, we found 2,461 papers. So we zeroed down to 2,461 papers. And we only gathered papers where happiness was measured specifically, where happiness was measured. We actually excluded certain papers, and we took only those which were measured qualitatively, and happiness was one of the categories. So finally, when we kind of zeroed down, we used Medley as one of the tools, and we zeroed down. We got 155 articles, and we looked at all these articles, and we found that we calculated the kind of percentages that arrived, how the happiness was being correlated with health, hope, and harmony subcategories related to the H theory model. So we arrived at simple percentages, and we looked at the key variables that were uncovered in most of these articles across the 3 domains. So once we arrived at the percentages that were derived, we kind of aligned those variables with the H theory model. And we found that we looked at the positive correlations and the negative correlations of those variables with the various categories and subcategories of those domains of health, happiness, and harmony. So we looked at totally 56 health studies, 23 hope studies, and 76 harmony studies. So we call them harmony, hope, and health studies because they were primarily looking at those areas, but we found a lot of overlap among those 3 domains. So out of a final count of 150 that we shortlisted, out of 2,675 articles, these studies, we shortlisted 155 because these studies showed a direct link between the factors of happiness and health, hope, and harmony. And these cross-cultural studies were conducted and they included over 100 countries, 44 cultures, including endogenous cultures and all gender types, female, male, and transgender. Across the study, researchers recruited anywhere between 100,000 participant sample sizes, with very few studies recruiting less than 100 participants per study. Majority of the samples consisted of a larger female gender distribution versus a male gender distribution, with a prominent age that ranged from 18 years and above. The most used self-report measures for happiness were the subjective happiness scale, Oxford happiness questionnaire, or a single item self-report questionnaire with or without a Likert scale, or a single happiness questionnaire from a national survey. Now, a total of 193 variables were found for the relevant findings in 155 happiness studies that positively or directly aligned with health, hope, and harmony domains, and the 9 subcategories that I mentioned, which was head, hope, and those subcategories. These variables helped inform and evidently support and enhance the H theory framework. Now, 79 variables were added to the health domain, out of which 63 variables showed a positive direct alignment, and 16 variables showed a negative or inverse alignment with the health domain. 41 variables were added to the hope domain, out of which 38 showed a positive direct alignment, and 3 showed a negative inverse alignment. And 73 were added to the harmony domain, out of which 53 showed a positive alignment, and 6 variables showed a negative alignment. What do we mean by positive and negative alignment? What is basically meant is a variable could contribute to happiness or could contribute to the health domain of the happiness, while having something would negate or reduce health or would reduce hope of that particular domain, in that particular domain. So having that would reduce it. So that's what is meant by positive and negative domain alignment. Now the H3 theory framework offers a comprehensive equifinality model of happiness. We haven't seen in this 80 years of research anything that actually is as comprehensive as what we've done. So based on the findings from the systematic review, happiness can be described as a product of the various subcategories of health, hope, and harmony, and each of which entails variables that were empirically supported across the studies and diverse cultures. In addition to the validation of the initially proposed variables, which were perhaps not more than about 25 or 30, this review also found further variables that were empirically supported and could be neatly organized within the framework. So we created a framework, which was like a hierarchical framework, which we presented it in a paper. Based on the exhaustive list of variables accumulated in the study, they were further organized into major themes across each of the subcategories of happiness. Now, the enhanced H theory framework highlights an equifinality development model for happiness and provides an integrated framework across the addition of 193 variables, out of which 161 are without duplicates, found across the 155 studies, which has been conceptualized across cultures and countries and diverse backgrounds. So 154 variables have positive alignment, and I think about 39 have a negative alignment. So we identified even negative alignment so that those could be kind of reduced as we work with patients having depression, or people at home with aged parents suffering from loneliness, and how that could impact them. And those negative factors could be removed from their life if that is highlighted as to what causes or reduces happiness. So the limitations of the study is there has been an overlap. What we saw was when we identified these various articles, an overlap was seen among studies that was allocated under each of the domains, because it was very difficult for us to actually demarcate with very sharp boundaries studies that had happiness and hope, studies that had happiness and harmony, because we found that hope, harmony, and health were kind of merging into each other in many of the studies. So a strict demarcation for separating studies under these three domains was not possible, except that we could kind of identify or focus studies as under hope, harmony, based on which of these studies was having either of these three domains as a central focus. So based on that, we kind of categorized them into hope, harmony, and health studies. Future research, I believe, could be in an area of one of these subcategories more in depth. And also it could be further investigated using advanced statistical tools such as confirmatory factor analysis or path modeling to make this more robust and to explain happiness. So our references were huge, like they spread across 4 or 5 pages, I think about 70 or 80 references, obviously, because it covered about 80 years of study. But here I've just listed a few references that I've covered in my paper. So if you have any questions, I'm willing to answer those.
Can I ask one question?
Please go ahead.
If I have a permission of the session chair. Okay, so it was a nice topic, Dr. Sunita. I just want to know, like you have mentioned that how did you go about and selecting the topics? I mean, you have shown the process. Finally, how did you arrive at 155 articles? And you selected the articles from EBSCO and other databases. So my question is, did you do it manually, that selecting the article? How did you go about it?
So we looked at these databases and we did keyword search first, and then we put it into Mendeley. And then we kind of, so it was basically firstly manual. It was a very laborious process for us. So we did a keyword search, we downloaded the PDFs, and then we uploaded them into Mendeley. And then we kind of took the abstracts, and then we looked at the abstracts, and then we created an Excel sheet. I could actually share the Excel sheet with you here, because this was something that I did in my previous research with Columbia University on meta-analysis. And this really helped give me the framework. So I'm just going to share you the...
I can see that. No, my only idea was that, you know, since I'm also doing some literature review as well as bibliometric analysis. So my only idea was that we select a database which is either Scopus or Web of Science, and we go the same way as you mentioned, that we do this keyword search, and then we can actually download a CSV there. So it saves a lot of labor work. We definitely have to go through each abstract and that, but labor work in terms of compiling into Excel and other things.
Yeah, right. That's a good idea. Actually, we didn't do that. We manually, can you see the screen of the Excel sheet?
So we
sat down and we actually categorized this into the study, the journal and the happiness measure being used, the sample size, and we looked at what are the relevant findings, and then we looked at what were the parameters that we were aligning it with, and then what category was that coming under, and then we kind of numbered it with our model, with our table. So we then drew percentages. So basically, it was a laborious process, and that's why it took us it took us 2 years.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. So now when you go to Scopus, you know, you can do keyword search and you can, you know, add whatever. For example, you are saying happiness, you want to do qualitative. So you can keep on adding those keywords with the condition like and or. And then maybe in 10 minutes, you will have the CSV. Now, once you generate the CSV, then it becomes pretty easy. You know, that too, if you feel that this is not relevant, delete it. If this is relevant, keep it.
I've done CSV, yes, it's a good idea. I've done CSV earlier, but I've never done CSV download for the databases, keyword search. I have not done it, but I would do it in the future, definitely. That's a good suggestion.
Yeah, so Scopus also allows, even Web of Science also allows, and you can use multiple filters. You can use the time period, you can use the language, you can use the themes, or the, you know, whether you want to take only conferences, you want to take only journals. So there are multiple.
But I'm not sure whether EBSCO allows it, because we were using EBSCO.
It does. It does.
It does? Okay.
Yeah. Okay. EBSCO also does, but the EBSCO search is much more wider. I mean, it gives you a lot of search. But I would suggest Scopus and Web of Science are much more precise. You know, it helps you to narrow down very much.
Yeah, and thank you, Dr. Aarti. That was a good input. Good. And maybe we could have saved a little time on that. But I think definitely going forward, we could do that.
Thank you.
Because we learn through this process, right? As I learn now.
That's true. It's a nice way of doing. You get to know who all have done actually research in that particular area. So literature review is very important. And it's a nice topic what you have selected, happiness. It's a very nice topic. My compliments to you. Thank you.
Okay, that's a good question, Dr. Aarti. We would have appreciated and allowed you more time to ask questions had you come on video. So now we have changed the rules of the conference in the last 10 minutes. Anybody wants to ask questions should come in the video. And of course, now you are there. So you can ask one more question. Go ahead.
No, it's not like that. I mean, being Sunday and because I was getting invitation from Agarwal sir, and Agarwal sir is so cooperative. So I thought I have attended all sessions. This is the only time, I think last 4 or 5 years, I'm not presenting the paper, but every time I have presented.
That's great. You know, so I think next conference, hopefully we are going to open up, pandemic will be over and everything will be back to normal, so we can look to meet at Rembrandt Hotel at Bangkok.
Yes, it is there.
So Dr. Agarwal is nice to everyone except the session chair. Actually, he keep on texting me the time frame and other things, etc. So that's interesting and very good. Input that came. Taxonomy, etc. is very important. But what's happening right now? Very rightly said by Dr. Aarti is about Web of Science. And Scopus by Elsevier, they are the only two major indexing that is considered now. So it's only Scopus and also slash Web of Science. So either it has to be Web of Science, WOS, or Scopus by Elsevier. And incidentally, these are not very old indexing, hardly 2004. If you look at Scopus, came in 2004, so not very old. Elsevier itself, 94, 96. Something, but of late I find that in last 20 years things have happened in a very faster mode, which was not earlier. And if you look at Indian context, InfibNet, which is the tracker and binding for all the listed indexed journals, they only considered Scopus or Web of Science. True. For any official listing and the accreditation purpose. So that is one input. Anything from any of our other friends?
The only thing that I would like to ask here is, like, for example, when we downloaded from Mendeley and when we were trying to take the author's details, we could actually just copy it straight in APA format. We didn't have to change anything. So when we copied the author details, we just used that in the referencing. So it came exactly in the APA format. We didn't have to make any changes. So I'm not sure whether when we download it in the CVC format, whether we would get that APA formatting.
I think you will get it. Okay. And even if you don't get it, say the majority is that you are looking at the papers which are 200, 500, 600. So that, I mean, that's how I work. I have no experience, and references may be 80 or 100. So I need to balance where do I need to save time. I need to save time in the proper extraction and references. Again, mostly you will get it. If you don't get it, I mean, what we do, we go to Google Scholar. You just type it, copy paste from Scopus, and then Scholar also gives you, you can copy from that in APA format.
Yeah, we because got not, Google Scholar also, yes.
Yeah.
Very good input, okay. All right. Now, I think one, two more questions. We have 1 minute time, but I think, we keep thinking about a question. Dr. Sunita, interview to ask you one question. So this is the project whereby you did about, qualitative matrices also ran through. Did you study about the factor about sharing, the happiness that comes in spite of having very little? By sharing the resources, because right now, what happened, as far as India is concerned and globally also, I think 12% of the population controls 56% of the wealth. So that means there is definitely not sharing at a broader platform. So what is this factor taken that happiness increases by sharing?
Yeah, actually, there are a lot of variables that we got. As I said, we got like 154 variables. It was related to a lot of themes, which I'm not able to share right now. But yes, environment was one of them, and resources was one of them. It spanned from mental health to transgender, change sexuality, to sharing of resources, to having animals. It spanned across the spectrum.
Okay, and was there any also factor taken about leadership of the country?
It was task. I think it was goal orientation, task, skill orientation. I'm not sure about leadership, because it was subjective analysis. It was mostly about subjective scale. It was not at the, how do I say, it was not at a, it was not a, at the country level, but it was about individual a level of analysis. What did the most of the studies were to do with what did people feel about happiness, not what government felt. It was not a meta-analysis of what countries feel about happiness. It wasn't
Not government. You'll find from that, you know, there are countries which are economically very poor. For example, Bhutan.
Yes, you know, we did take what happiness.
Because they take their leadership, as if happiness drives from the leadership. They feel so happy about the ethical leadership that their king enjoys, and also the prime minister enjoys among the population.
Yeah, the countries, as I said, 100 countries, we had poor countries, we had Sudan, we had Ethiopia, we had Canada, we had 100 countries is a lot, right? So what are indigenous cultures? What do happiness mean to indigenous cultures who have very little to survive on?
What does happiness mean? Okay, sure, please go ahead.
It was across, yeah.
Okay, but don't you think that, you know, if you look at given the diverse socio-geographical anthropological factors, the African nations have got, European nations have got, it's very, skewed to compare the respondent from these countries, because the happiness measurement will be in the given, the really term will be in a given socio-geographical demographic area.
Yes, but that was interesting for us to understand that we could actually bring it back to the framework. Despite the diversity, despite the fact across cultures, we could bring it back and we could identify that these belong to harmony. This belong to head. This belong to health. This belong to hope. We could categorize them under those categories, on those domains, because we didn't see happiness fall beyond those domains.
Thank
we
you
couldn't
so
come
much
out with the fourth domain of happiness.
Thank you so much for the lovely work, and this is very detailed work, and I think the way Professor Sunita told about its ongoing work, and they are not able to disclose many things due to the work is still going on. So, but massive work, because such kind of work is very difficult to be carried out in a small group. So like rightly 2 years, she has put, and anybody in the conference, any friend wants to ask more questions or interact with Dr. Sunita, please catch a flight to Dubai and ask.
Email as well. And this has been under peer review by an ADBC journal since June this year. So hopefully they should be able to finalize by December, because sometimes they take a year. So
congratulations, very good. So friends, with this, we've come to the conclusion. So we have very interesting papers. Let me slightly just summarize it. We had paper number 12164 about predicting market and CSR expenditure by Dr. Suraj Shah and the team of researcher, which they talk about causal analysis, affecting the affliction in the market and their image. So that was a wonderful paper. We missed narrowly Dr. Gurpreet for data estimation paper, but she has submitted in absentia. So we acknowledge her contribution as well. We had a next scholar and our professor, 2167 paper code, impact of critical factors of e-learning on learning outcome and students' satisfaction with respect to the graduate aptitude test by Professor Renuka and her team of a researcher from Chitkara Business School and other schools. Wonderful work, because, and then she also answered a lot of questions about whether it was going to be about a closed group, a small group, online, hybrid, a lot of things she tried to attempt. We had a next paper, 2168, which was about benchmarking efficient units of energy index, especially using data envelopment analysis and also TOPSIS. This is very complex work, because using DEA, you know that it's very complex work, but they did a lot of good work about that. So it was by Professor Vishal and presented by, Professor Deepika, if I'm not wrong. So the penultimate paper we had, 2169, was board structure and financial statements frauds by Dr. Deepika and her team. She talked about independent directors, women director, and also about discussion went around the strategy, structure, system for prevention of the frauds in the financial market and also corporate governance, especially at the backdrop of MCA21 project. And we were keeping the sessions live and hot by time Dr. Sunita was driving from her home and to reach her to her office. And so 2172, the last paper by Dr. Sunita Chhatriya and her team about S theory framework, systematic review of happiness through cross-cultural perspective. Very detailed work, large variables, 150 plus, large number of nations with a team of large scholars and the faculty members. So this was very interesting, and we had a very good question and answer for this. So on behalf of ICMIS, the last session, our personal thanks to each one of our friends who have joined this morning in ICMIS conference, and hope that we meet next year in Bangkok in a more relaxed manner and have more time to discuss. So with this, we come to an end of the conference. So I request conference chair, Professor Shiv Prakash Agarwalji, to do the formal closure.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Suryavanshi, for chairing this session. As it was a final session, which was their third session, final session for this ICMIS 21. And I can see like still momentum in this generally, you know, when we would get into the last session, momentum goes down. We start, you know, feeling tired about it. But we got a good presence also from different countries. We have got a presence of Thailand, Germany, I can see, US, I can see, Dubai, I can see from here. And I think Japan, if there's a five, six countries, I can see out of 21 participants at this moment joined from different part of the world. Thank you everybody for joining this conference and participating, presenting the papers, hearing the session. Dr. Suryavanshi, for this, your most welcome. Next year we will have ICMIS 22. That we'll be completing, in fact, like this will be 10th conference in Bangkok. ICMIS 13 we started with, and now 10th conference ICMIS 22 will be there next year in September. Dates will be decided depending upon how our great friend Rembrandt is providing beautiful lunch. Depending upon that, we'll plan out our activities and all. Thank you, all of you.